Hi there, this is Greg Howe. Glad you can make it. Hopefully in the next hour or so we can talk about some of the ideas and some of the techniques that I use as part of my playing. Do a lot of neat two-handed things and some warm-up exercises that might also help your alternate picking a little bit. Arpeggios, just a whole bunch of stuff. It'll be a lot of fun. But before we do any of that, we should probably tune together. So here's a high E. B, G, D, A, and low E. Alrighty, we're going to do some warm-up exercises. A lot of you probably just want to jump right in and do all the flashy stuff, but it's a good idea to probably warm up first. The guitar is an instrument that you express yourself emotionally with, but aside from that, it's also pretty physically demanding activity. So you want to warm up. This first exercise that we're going to do, or warm up, is an exercise that I do. It takes place only on the high E string and the B string. Aside from being a good exercise for different finger shapes and that kind of thing, it's a real good alternate picking exercise too. This particular one it's going to be in the key of A minor, and it's going to start on the note D with the little finger, and we're going to start with a downstroke. And you're going to play C and B right after that. You got this kind of shape. The fourth note is going to be a C again with the index finger. Get used to sliding with the index finger because you're going to be doing an awful lot of that. Continue. D. E. So far we have this. Then you're going to go back to the D, back to the C. That's everything on the high E string. It's going to be a 16th note oriented pattern. You'll recognize it as soon as we get going. Right after that, continue the notes B, A, and G on the B string. And slide up to the A again on the B string with the index finger. Continue. Play B and C on the B string. It probably sounds a little confusing. It's not. Let me just play it slow once. Right after that, I'm going to continue, end the whole 16th note phrase with D and E again on the high E string. So you can hear it's like it's a one measure lick, 16th notes, and it's. So you can hear the 16th notes. A good way to remember this sequence is think 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 slide, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3 slide, 1, 2, 3, 4, because that's where the index finger is doing the sliding. We're just going to continue. It'll be the same thing. Keep it in A minor, and you'll start on F this time. It's going to be the same sequence, but it'll be a harmony to that. So I'll play everything slow. Take it up one more. We'll start on the note A this time. Same sequence. You can end with C. The C would be the one of the next measure. So if you play it comfortably, you'll hear the 16th notes. Take the descending version of that. You start on the note C, that would be the one. The only difference between the ascending version and the descending version is the index finger is now going to be sliding down on four, or one, instead of. So you're sliding down. Everything else is exactly the same. Start on C. So you can see it's the same thing. So slide. It's the exact same thing backwards. Just remember the slides are in the same place, but they're going down now instead of up. So I'll just run through the whole descending scale or exercise slowly. You get to this point, to turn it around so that you can continue going up and down, you know, without stopping. Think of one slide down, one slide up. So you'll let me just run through that real slow so you can see what I'm doing. Starting on the D that we originally started on. But the second time, sliding up from the E to the F. So then you can just continue the whole thing over and over again. That sets you back up to where you were before. continue up and down. The next section is going to involve the other four strings. It's another warm-up exercise, and it's going to be a ascending and descending scale that just goes straight up and straight down. The weird thing about this is that it's going to be based on four notes on a string as opposed to three, which a lot of you are probably used to. This particular scale, with the exception of the very first string, will have four notes on every string. And again, it's going to be the index finger doing all of the work. The index finger will be playing two of the four notes that you hear. So let me give you an example. Remember, I said with the exception of the first string, the lowest string, you'll be playing four notes on per string. So start on the note A. Because of the way we're going to descend, I'm starting with an upstroke. So if you want to do it the way I'm doing it, start with an upstroke. You'll play down on the note D on the A string, and then the index finger will go up to E and play two notes on the A string. And you play F and G as you normally would, so you can see. Just continue. Play down on the note A on the D string, and again the index finger will slide up to B. That will be an upstroke. Continue. C and D. One more string. Hit the note E on the G string, and the index finger will slide up again, getting the note F. So the index finger is getting two notes on every string. Then end with G and A. So the whole scale slow. That's the ascending version of the scale. Might not seem like a big deal now, but it can be real beneficial, because we'll add another octave onto that, and I'll show you in a minute. That kind of thing is easier for me. I'm always going to the adjacent string with the same stroke, and for me it's just a lot easier. So there I played a two octave scale, and haven't even gotten to the B string or the E string yet. The descending version of that is going to be the exact opposite. I'll be playing three notes on the G string and four notes on every other string. So whereas we hit this E on the way up, this time we'll play the E on the D string on the way down. So you will have ended with an upstroke, supposedly, and A, G, and F. And then you play E, D, and C, and B on the D string. Those are your four notes. On the A string, you play A, G, F, and E. And then play D, C, B, and A on the low E string. So you've got four notes on every string except the G string when you're descending. And you should end with an upstroke so that you can continue. In other words, the last note of the descending scale will be the first note of the ascending scale, and vice versa. So the descending version is. The next warm-up exercise is pretty much the same thing, but we're going to tack on the third octave. And it's going to be the same idea. You're playing four notes on the string. The only problem now is that you have to jump up two frets to hit this note B. So you will have ended here with an upstroke. You have to jump up two frets, hit the B, and then again you slide up to the C and add D and E. And we're going to end it with only three notes on the high E string because of the way that we're going to descend. So just play F, G, and A on the high E string. So the whole thing slow from the low A. And there's your jump. So just work on that, and you can play a three octave scale playing four notes on the per string. to descend from this scale, I'm going to have a completely different approach. I don't descend the same way that I ascended. I'm going to have four notes on the high E string. What this will do is, I ended the last note, the high A, with a downstroke. So I'm going to play four notes descending on the high E string. This way I'll end with an upstroke. I can hit the B string with a downstroke. So I'll be playing four notes on the high E string and four notes on the B string. Now here's the weird part. I'm only going to play two notes on the G string, G and F. And the rest is going to be four notes. So you're playing four notes on every string descending except the G string. You're only playing two. And what this allows me to do is always be going to the adjacent string with a downstroke. So let me just go through it slow once. And again, I'll end with an upstroke so I can continue doing the up and down version over and over again. Here's another approach to three octave scales that might make it a little bit easier for you mentally to think about. By keeping the same shape for each scale, it might make it easier for you to see the scale and make it easier for you to play the scale. I'm going to stay in A minor, only this time I'm going to start on the note B, and I'll play four notes on the first string I'm starting on, which is the low E. Play B, C, D, and E. And I'll play three notes on the next string, F, G, and A. And that gives us a one octave scale. If you look at that shape, the index finger is playing B and C. You have four notes on the first string, three on the second, then that's your scale. Play the same thing right here. And then one more time. The picking is going to change. The way I descend, because of the way I descend, I'm going to start with an upstroke just like I did before. And if that's the case, then the next time I get to the first note of the same shape, octave higher, I'll have to start with a downstroke. Up, down, and then up again for the third octave. But the index finger is playing four notes, B, C, D, and E, and every octave. B, C, D, and E. So that might make it easier for you. To descend, I don't use the three identical scale idea. I do it differently because I always like to make sure I hit an adjacent string with a downstroke, especially when I'm descending. It's just easier for me. But an easy way to think about the descending version of this is think four notes on every string except the high E string will only be three and the G string will be two. So let me just run you through that once. You will have ended with an upstroke on the note A. So to descend, you play out of this shape right here, and then play four notes on the B string. So you've only got three on the high E string, A, G, and F, and then four on the B string, E, D, C, and B. Then only two notes on the G string, A and G, and four notes on every other string. Just play the descending scale slow once. I'm always going to the next string with a downstroke. So I ended with an upstroke, and I can just continue the same thing using the identical shape idea, going up and the hitting adjacent strings with downstrokes for the descending. using that same idea for a harmonic minor scale can be really useful. Again, stay in A minor. We'll start on the G sharp, or the 7, and we play four notes, G sharp, A, B, and C, and then D, E, and F, and just do the same thing in octaves again. And descending will be exactly the same thing. You'll have three notes on the high E string, two notes on the G string, and four notes on every other string. So let me just run that through real slow. Descending has a couple of weird shapes, and let me just run through it real quick.
Judy, I'm terribly sorry. I know you're busy and everything. I was just walking by the hallway and I heard the way you were going so fast on it. That's true, you make. Well, listen, I know you're busy. Why not? I'll talk to you just a little
bit. Thanks. All righty. You start with, you're going to start on the note?
One more thing, sir. Is that coming, that color, or...
I'm in the middle of the video right now. I'm doing
you're right. When you're right, you're right. I'll talk to you later.
Okay. I'm starting on the note F, and basically I'm going to pull off to E, and then...
Keep it up. It's fantastic.
You'll have three notes on the high E string, like I said. You'll have F, E, and D. And you should have ended with an upstroke with the ascending scale, so the D will be an upstroke on the way down. You have four notes on the B string, C, B, A, and G sharp. You have two notes, again, on the G string, F and E. D, C, and B, and A on the D string. And then G sharp, F, and E. That's kind of a weird stretch, but that's no big deal. All the way down to the D. So you're going to have four notes, and then four notes on the low E string. C, B, A, G sharp. So descending. And just play it over and over until you can go up and down fast. Another real good warm-up is an exercise I use. It's ascending and descending four notes at a time on one string. And it's a real good control exercise for coordinating the left and right hand together. We'll keep this in A minor too. Start on the note A with a downstroke and the index finger. You get used to the index finger sliding around. The index finger will slide up to B with an upstroke. And then you just tack on the C and the D. And then you just do that same thing over and over again, staying diatonically in A minor. One, two, three. The beginning of each four notes starts with a downstroke. And to descend, use the last note of the ascending scale as the first note of the descending scale. So you should have ended with an upstroke. That'll be the first note of the descending scale. And now the index finger is sliding, but it's playing the third and fourth note. And do the same thing over and over again. That's the toughest part. If you want to continue going up and down, you'll have to slide twice down to the A because you're descending and ascending real quickly at the same time. So practice all these exercises and get comfortable with them, combine them all together, and practice them in different keys. I'd like to show you some of my favorite licks, some of the licks that I use all the time. And a lot of these won't necessarily be picking every note, so it'll be a little bit something different. One of the licks I use all the time is a lick that ascends and descends four notes, but I don't pick every note. I hammer on and then pick the high note. Do this one in A minor. I'll start on the note C and hammer on to the D and hammer on to the E on the B string. I sort of have the 13th fret barred. I'm hitting up on the F. And then I'm picking all the notes coming back down. And what that allows me to do is get a lot more speed that way. I can add a note onto that just by sliding down to the B and then up again. I'll probably pick the B along with all the other notes on the way down. You can do a lot of things with barring. I do a lot of things like that, where I'm barring the high E string and the B string. I do a lot of blues licks that way. Here's another easy kind of lick that sounds kind of cool. I'll do this example in E. This will be like an E blues lick. All you're doing is hitting up on the high E string and down on the B string on the note D and pulling that off to a B, kind of a pentatonic thing. And then you're hitting the note A on the G string. And then you're going back up again. The way I'm picking it is up on the E string and down on the other two. But when I ascend, I'm hitting up on the B string. Let me just play it for you slow and I'll speed it up. That's one of my favorite licks. One of the cool things you can do with that is add, instead of playing the A, play the flat five, which in this case would be B flat. By doing that, you just, instead of hitting this note A, kind of stretch that finger up and hit the B flat. It gives a real bluesy sound if you play it fast. And, you know, you can use that as part of the lick that descends or the cool thing about barring licks is just by pivoting the third finger, you can do the same picking but get different notes by, you know, barring with the third finger too. What I'm doing here is I'm hitting down on the B string, up on the E, back down on the D, or the B string, but the note D, pulling it off to a B, and then that same pull-off is also a hammer-on up to D again, but instead of hitting up on the E, this time I will have barred this finger, I'm hitting up on the note G. So let me just play it slow so you see what I'm talking about. Another lick I use a lot. And again, you can add that note on the G string and just kind of come up with variations of that kind of idea. And that's one of my favorite licks. Another barring lick is that I use in, for kind of a bluesy thing is, all, we'll use this example in E too. Slide down to the 10th fret, bar these two notes, and hammer on from the A to the B on the B string, and then bar the third finger so you're hitting up on the note E, and then pull that off. you have to, you know, hit down again on the beat, pull it off. The thing you can add to that to make it sound real bluesy is the flat five. It sounds kind of weird, slow, but it sounds cool when you play it fast. Pull the flat five off to the A again, so you're pulling B flat off to A, and just play that sequence. That's one of my favorite licks. Another blues lick that's barring sounds similar to that. This is kind of weird because you'll be barring with the second finger this time. Start on the flat five, or the 11th fret of the B string. That would be the flat five. Hammer on to the B, and then up on the note E. So the second finger is the finger that's barring. Hit back down on the note B, and pull it off. Then with your third finger, reach up and hit the D on the B string. The whole thing slow is going to sound like this. Sounds kind of weird slow again, but if you play it fast, it sounds kind of nasty. One of my favorites. Take that same barring idea and use it on some of the other strings. You can go like right across the fretboard barring. That's another thing I do a lot, which is, let me just show you what it is. If I was an E, say E blues, start on the note A, and I'd hammer onto the B, and then bar with the third finger up on the note E. Then hit the B again, pull it off to A. Then just, at that point, after you've gotten down to the A, just do a simple pentatonic hammer-on to the B, to the D, and to the E. Let me just show it to you slow so you see what I'm talking about. At that point, you're going to bar again and do the same sequence, but on the next two sets of strings. So what you have is... The only weird part is when I hit that C sharp, and if I'm in E blues, then that note works. Technically, if we were doing the exact pattern all the way up, I'd, keeping it pentatonic, I should have hit the D, but I'm not going to do that because I want to keep it easy for me. And the last shape would be a minor third distance, or three frets. So the whole thing sound like this. One of my all-time favorites. And right now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you my very first guitar instructor, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Sidney Crumpf.
Well, Greg, it certainly is a pleasure to be here out there in there. You've come quite the ways, haven't you?
Thank you.
Greg Howe. Howe, well, Greg, why don't you play for the folks the very, very first thing I've taught you?
Well, the very first thing you taught me, I don't know if
Well, that would be your C, A minor, F, G, half gainer, full twelfth side of French. Try that.
I don't remember that one.
Just try it, Greg, all right?
That last note.
Would be. Try that last.
Is that it?
That's close enough. Boy, has he come. Greg, all the best. I'm going to get back to class now, and it certainly was a pleasure meeting, and bye.
He's a great guy. I hope I see him again real soon, like within the next 20 years or so. Well, time to have some fun. Get to use both hands on the fretboard. I do a lot of two-handed things, and I try to make sure that when I do them, they almost don't sound like two-handed licks. They sound more like runs or extremely fast legato lines. It would be hard to do with just one hand. One of the licks I use a lot, and again, I'll keep this in A minor so we can be easier to talk about. It's a triplet pattern that's, I usually use it in a descending form, but let's go up to the Dorian position here in A minor. We'll start on the note D, and what you're going to do is position the left hand on D, E, and F, those three notes. And the lick will actually start on the note G with the right hand. I use my middle finger because I do a lot of things where I'm trading off back and forth between hammer-ons and picking and two-handed things, and so this way I don't have to think about what I have to do with the pick. Anyway, we'll start on G. You're going to play that note. That'll be the first note. You just tap it with the right hand. Pull it off, and you'll get the note F. Pull the F off to an E, and then re-tap the F with the right hand. It's going to be a triplet feel. You'll start hearing it. After you've tapped that F with the right hand, pull it off to the E, and then pull the E off to the D, and then re-tap the E. So far we have this. Right after that, to keep the triplets going, you're going to have to hammer on to the note C with the left hand. And then you're going to tap the note D with the right hand. So we had D on the E string the first time. This time we'll have it on the B string. After you've gotten to that point, you're pretty much back to where you were when we first started. You just do the same sequence. To keep it going all the way across the fretboard, you'll only have to tap two times on the G string, just because of the way the pattern is. After you've gotten down to the B on the B string, and you've pulled it off to the A, the left hand by itself will tap the G note on the G string. The right hand will tap the note A on the G string. When you get to that point, just pull it off to the G, pull the G off, re-tap the G with the right hand, and then the left hand will tap E on the D string. The right hand will tap the F. Going to be the same pattern. The shapes will be a little bit different, but if you know your scales and if you know what A minor is, then you just do the same exact idea. You take it down as far as you want. You can, until you run out of strings or until your hands collide with each other, which might create even a cooler effect. Another variation of that is a blues idea, or a pentatonic idea. Keep it in A, jump down here. It's going to be the same idea, but you won't be tapping as many times on one string. I'll start here on the note D on the high E string. This time it's going to be a little bit backwards. You'll be tapping two times on the high E string and on the B string. And then if you just want to play it pentatonically, then you'll tap two times on the G string also. And two times on the D string and two times on all the strings. If you want to get the flat five in there and make it sound really bluesy, Then you'll tap three times on the G string. When you get to this point, instead of going to the note D, go to E flat or D sharp, and then tap on the E, pull that off to the flat five, pull the flat five off, re-tap it with the right hand, pull it off, get the note D, pull it off, re-tap the D. Just do the same idea, except you'll be tapping three times on the G string. So. I use that a lot. You could go up again with it, you could ascend with it, but it's a little bit more difficult. That a lot. It's one of my favorite licks, and another good two-handed lick that doesn't sound like a two-handed lick, or it doesn't sound like an arpeggiated that kind of thing that you've heard many times, is an ascending run that I use a lot. I'll do this one in A major. I'll start on the note E, and what I'm going to be doing basically is just playing three notes per string. Two of the notes will be with the left hand, and the third note will be with the right hand. The only difficult thing about this is that if you're not real careful, strings start ringing out because, you know, you don't have this hand over against the bridge to mute anything. But just keep working on it and you'll have it no problem. It'll be fun. We'll start on E and just basically play E and F sharp and then tap the G sharp with the right hand. Do the same thing. This particular pattern will be the same shape on the first three strings, so after you've gotten there, just do an octave of the same thing. You'll start here. You have to jump up a fret on the B string, then start it again. And you don't have that the last three notes because you ran out of strings finally, but you get a lot of speed with that, probably faster than anyone's left hand if you work on it. I'd like to show you some arpeggios and some wide interval licks. Recently, arpeggios seem to have become pretty popular amongst rock guitar players, and they're very useful. There's a couple real advantages to arpeggios. Number one, they sound real impressive because they can cover a lot of ground quickly, and more importantly, they look impressive because they can cover a lot of ground quickly. They can sometimes help expand the sound of a chord. For instance, if you played an E minor arpeggio over a C major chord, it could help bring out the major seventh tonality of the chord or something like that. That kind of thing, you know, they help widen the sound of whatever it is you're playing over. Some of the techniques involved in arpeggios are sweep picking. If any of you are familiar with that, then maybe this won't be that helpful to you, but if you're not familiar with it, I have a couple of exercises for sweep picking. I don't sweep pick as much as a lot of people think I do, but I do sweep a little bit, and I'll show you one of the exercises right now. This will be a C major triad, and it's going to involve two different positions. The ascending sweep will be a different position than the descending sweep. But you can combine them both together and have a large two and a half octave arpeggio. So I'll show it to you. I'm starting with a downstroke on the note C with my middle finger. I'm playing the E. on the A string. Then I'm hammering on to the G note of the A string. And this will all be one sweep downward. When you get to the D string, you hit that with a downstroke, and that's your octave. When you get to the G string, you play the E again. And then just kind of bar that fret. To come back down, what I'm going to do is you hit that high E. The way I do it, I hit that high E with an upstroke, and then I slide up to the G with a downstroke. And that's the end of the ascending version of the arpeggio. So we've sweeped until we got to the E string, then we started alternate picking. You get to that high G, that will have been a downstroke. Hit up on the E note, and then you'll play this position. Just a different position for C major again. And that'll be all upstrokes from the time you hit the E note. Until you get right here, then you alternate pick again, at least the way I do it. So when you get to that C, you're going to jump all the way down to the G on the A string, and that will be with a different stroke, downstroke, and then up on the note E of the low E string, and down again on the C, and then you can just continue that. Build it up until it gets faster and you're comfortable with it. Another approach to two-octave arpeggios that I use a lot is a technique that doesn't involve so much sweeping, but it's more of a picking thing. And it's, for me, a lot more comfortable. And you can play just as fast, and in some ways it sounds a little bit smoother. I'll give you an example. Start on the A string. We'll do it in C again. Play the note C on the A string. Then hammer on to the third. And then bar with your middle finger the D string and the G string. And the way I'm picking that is downstroke on the A string, a downstroke on the D string, and an upstroke on the G string. Then you're going to jump up two frets, or to the fret where your middle finger was, but with your index finger, and bar the B string and the E string. Hammer on from here, from the E to the G, and then bar up to the C. The advantage to this is that you can play a very fast one-octave arpeggio in a high position. That kind of thing. And, you know, to play it. That kind of arpeggio works nice for me. Descending is a little difficult. You're going to pretty much do the same thing. Remember, you've hit up on the high C. And you're doing that same idea that we did back with the blues lick. Except, you know, keep it a triad. You have to jump back down here with your middle finger, hit up on the G. You just do the same thing backwards. The minor version to that is almost identical fingering-wise and picking-wise. All you have to do is make a couple of minor adjustments. instead of hammering on a major third, hammer on a minor third, and you'll still have the same thing there with the middle finger. This time, instead of jumping up to this fret, jump up a half step down from that, but you'll be hammering on to the same place that you were hammering. So you're just taking the third and making it minor. And this is a little bit easier, actually. Aside from just arpeggios and triads, I do a lot of wide interval things that sound kind of like arpeggios because they cover a lot of distance, but they're actually not. They're just wide interval scales. I don't have time to show you a lot of the things that you can do, but I'll show you one lick, and this might be able to just open some doors. This will be for E minor. I'm starting on the note A on the D string. I'm just playing like a pentatonic form right there. Then with the right hand, I'll tap to the A on the G string. Right after that, I'll jump up to the B note with my index finger of the left hand, and then hammer on to the note D. So I'm picking and I'm tapping and all kinds of stuff. From that point, you can do what you want to do. You could maybe just take it that high, maybe add on an E. Or you could add on a higher note. Any note that's in the key, or anything that you're trying to, whatever you want it to sound like, add that note to it.